Good morning, friends. A joy to welcome you into the life and work of this very special church family. Yay. We're grateful you're here, and if you're joining us online, we're blessed to know that you've made the effort to connect that way as well. Sycamore is always a great place and lots of good things happening in our life and work. We want to encourage you kindly because it will help us do a better job of being mindful of who has shared in our worship time today. So use the friendship pads. That helps us connect and be alert to the wonderful folk we're seated together with. Highlighting a couple of things. B. Essler, a longtime member of this church family, recently passed away. Her funeral service is tomorrow. Visitation at 10 a.m. Service at 11 a.m. at Christ Church Mason in the chapel where her children belonged. We wanted to help make you all aware of that. We also want to alert you that if you have room, or even if you don't have room, to ingest pancakes, this is a sacred day in which to do that. All the money benefits of coming mission from our student ministries, it's down the hall toward Fellowship Hall. I have already had the privilege of partaking. Tim would remind me, well, you could do it again. Yes, you're creative in that way. But if you can, it's a great way to encourage a very special ministry and our young folk who are providing leadership for the making of pancakes today. A couple of things we want to highlight: an upcoming date night as a part of our family ministry program. This coming Saturday, which is May the 2nd, from 5:30 to 8 p.m., it's a scavenger hunt. Child care is provided. Outreach Day, Saturday, April the 6th. Last year, we involved somewhere around 160-plus people in this shared effort as we deployed people all around the community. It'll be even larger this year. You can sign up today out in the cafe area. Look for the serve table. And then Ash Wednesday, not far off, really a week from Wednesday night, March the 6th, 7 p.m., featuring the imposition of the ashes. And it's a very moving time in terms of preparing for the Lenten season. So many things happening in our wider life and work. Find a place to connect, to belong, to share, to serve, to worship, and be blessed. Let's prepare our hearts to worship God.
Please join me for the call to worship. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Then I will teach others your ways. For you do not delight in sacrifice. May we be glad and rejoice, for the Lord has done great things for us. Together, let us worship God. God is eager to forgive us. His love for us is deeper than we can imagine, and he welcomes our confession and offers us complete forgiveness. Knowing this and in this hope, together let us pray the prayer of confession. Painfully, we come face to face with our own sin. We confess before you, O God, that we hide from others what we are and pretend to be than we know ourselves to be. We want to make a good impression and blame others for our faults. We are slow to forgive those who have offended us, yet we are quick to justify our own mistakes. Forgive us for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us continue with a moment of silent and personal confession. Amen. Hear the good news. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone. Behold, a new life has come. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. Please be seated. Our scripture reading this morning comes to us from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 28 to 30. Hear God's word as I share it with you. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. The word of the Lord.
Friends, will you please pray with me? Gracious Lord, you know that we all have those windows when we really yearn for rest. More than anything, may we confidently rest in you and in the fullness of your care made real through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. There is a pushing, pressing, pummeling sound to human life. And sometimes we'd like to back away. We'd like to be able to step out of our lane for a while and just be at a rest area and take a breather. If there's one part of our shared humanity that Jesus especially identified with, it was our need for rest. You and I have a need for rest. We have a right to rest. And at times, our lives may depend upon our willingness to rest. We live in a world where rest is sometimes viewed as an optional commodity, like it's a perk or a benefit that we are entitled to once we've gotten all of our real work done. Then we have permission to perhaps step into a period of rest, as long as it's not for too long. You see, we have great difficulty assimilating the fact that work and rest are part of the same creative process. Usually, our tendency is to work harder still. And then at the end of all that, rest becomes something that we might entertain, but often not until then. And such a view is really counter to the scriptures. We need look no further than the book of Genesis and recognize that work and rest are intimately tied together. You look on those magnificent descriptions of the creation of life, the birthing of this world and the universe. And then we read that on the seventh day, God rested from all of the labor which the Lord God had been about. Now, sometimes, you know, we have these debates about how everything came to be. Some of us are Big Bang theorists. Others see a guided process of evolution. Others rest in the literal descriptions of creation. And however all of this came to be, whatever the tactics were which God used, it comes down to this fundamental and foundational question, and that is this: do you see it as being God-breathed? That's really what it's all about. Well, we sometimes fail when it comes to entertaining that opportunity for rest. But without rest, we really can't be our best. Big John Wallace, who was a part of the Harry Chapin band, I heard Harry a couple of times live. Big John said there was one 17-day period where Harry slept every day in a chair somewhere in an airport as he would make his way each day after a concert to Washington, where he was lobbying for particular legislation. He later would be awarded the Medal of Freedom for his efforts. He didn't particularly take good care of himself. He died tragically at 38. Some think he had a heart attack, which caused a car accident, and some think the car accident caused the heart attack. Sometimes there are those windows where we push back rest for some greater pursuit, and we can do that as long as we understand it's just temporary, because we can't sustain that kind of model ultimately we are wired with a need for rest. And sometimes our best creativity is dependent upon our willingness to rest. I did something this week I've never done before. I listened to Bruckner's Ninth Symphony. Now, many of you know Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, but the works of Anton Bruckner are a little more obscure. He was a man of deep, deep faith. And I had owned the CD for over 15 years, and I'd never played it. Different style. I guess one might call it more Germanic. But I was intrigued because there was a day when one of Bruckner's students, well over 125 years ago, said this to Anton Bruckner, "Master, how did you create that divine motif for your Ninth Symphony?" And Bruckner explained. He said, "Well, I was on a walk along the river. It was time to eat lunch. I sat down. I unwrapped my cheese sandwich from that greasy wax paper. And after eating lunch, I got back up and began to continue my walk along the Carlsberg River. And then that darn tune popped into my head." Sometimes in the act of resting, there's another part of our brain that is released. Sometimes solutions come when you step back from having to press the question before you. And sometimes it's a new perspective, sometimes it's an insight, sometimes it's just a peacefulness that says, "I'm going to get through this. It's going to be okay. It's not catastrophic. There is an answer." As my wife Joyce sometimes likes to say, we were able to land a man on the moon. We're probably able to handle this one. Sometimes the act of resting really releases part of our own capability. And suddenly we think differently about our circumstances at hand, and sometimes it's our opportunity to invite God into the conversation. We sometimes, when we release control, are freed to be more God-minded and maybe even pray. And in the midst of that, we have a shift in our awareness. And suddenly things come onto our radar that weren't there before because we have so tightly clinched our lives. I began by saying life is filled with the experience of feeling pressed and pushed and pummeled. Rest. One of the things I have experienced and appreciated are the musical gifts of Glenn Campbell. He was a man of great, great faith. He'd had a rough period. But sometimes music can help figuratively describe the life that seizes us and doesn't allow room for rest. And when I came upon this, I thought, I've just got to share it. Because if you're like me, you have never heard an excerpt from the William Tell Overture played on a guitar. Just sit back.
Anything else? Hi, old Silver, away! Get him up, Scout! Thank you.
You get the idea, right? Something about a fast-paced life where you're not going to let up. You have to continue to drive hard. There's no room for rest in that conversation. I'm struck because sometimes if you were to come into my office, you might hear Bruckner's Ninth Symphony. You might hear Dolly Parton. You might hear the Beatles or Motown. You might hear Merle Haggard. You might hear Mario Lanza. You might hear the William Tell Overture. Something about music sometimes challenges us to do something we don't do very well all of the time, and that is to listen. And part of what Jesus is challenging us to do is to listen to the heartbeat of God, which often invites us to experience a different rhythm in life. And so Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who labor, heavy laden, bent beneath your burdens, and I will give you peace. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am meek and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Jesus and his father Joseph were regarded as making the best fitting yokes in the county as carpenters. The yoke being easy means it fits well. You can't pull every load. You don't have that capacity, and sometimes life is chafing. We feel like we're rubbed raw. We really don't have a capacity to weather much more. And Jesus understands that we are bent beneath our burdens. The world of his day was characterized by physical stress and distress. He knows when we don't feel up to the task, when we are insecure and we can't let go, we can't let up for fear that something will happen. And yet in Christ's care, we have a clarity about Jesus being in the picture, that our real worth, our ultimate value comes not from what you and I are going to be able to achieve or accomplish or create, although that can have a short-term benefit. Our deepest value and security, our greatest sense of restfulness, will be having confidence in what our Lord wants to bring into our very lives and breathe into us as God breathed into creation. To trust it and to somehow recognize that this Lord would persevere for our sakes, even when we are resistant and unwilling. The Lord is unwavering. And the cross and Jesus' resurrection reminds us he will pay every price that we might rest confidently in his care. Oh, we are a driven lot some days. And we often feel that to rest means we are somehow weakened or inadequate, not up to the ultimate work at hand. But one of the beautiful things about rest is it may free us in a window of time to allow more God thoughts to emerge, to receive a help, a support, an encouragement that is divine, because it too is God-breathed. And it somehow comes into our midst recognizing just where we need to be touched, because we are often worn and ragged. And we're afraid to rest. And yet we can't be at our best if we won't rest. Franklin Delano Roosevelt, as President of the United States, navigating the tensions, the demands of World War II, would sometimes return to his boyhood home in Hyde Park, New York, go up the steps to his childhood bedroom and sleep 12 to 14 hours. You've heard that line, to lie down to pleasant dreams. He knew he needed rest and couldn't function without it. I worked with a colleague, man I greatly admire, 40 years ago. And I was struck when Harold would say this, "I demit my ordination every night when I go to bed. I give it up." He said, "I have to commit the best of what I have endeavored to do into God's sustaining care, which alone is able to run the universe. That's not in my toolkit, but to rest in what God can do, which is surely far different than what we can do." How ready and willing are we to trust the fabric of that relationship? And to know it comes to us not out of a sense of duty, but out of a sense of affection. There's a wonderful scene in the Gospels where Jesus is obviously physically spent. You can imagine the demands that were made on him. "Master, can you come to my house? Our child is ill. Nobody else has been able to help him. Please, Lord, before it's too late." Or, "Jesus, my wife has a raging fever. I'm afraid we're going to lose her. Surely you can do something for her. Help." Wherever Jesus turned, there was a request, there was a need. And he had the religious folk plotting against him. The political leaders would have been happy if the Jesus problem went away. And when he had opportunity, he would teach the masses. As Mark told us, they were like sheep without a shepherd. Yearning to be upheld by something they had never experienced from within. In Mark's gospel, we have this amazing scene of our Lord and Savior asleep in the middle of the boat. They're out on the lake. A storm is blowing up. The wind is whipping it up like today. The waves are crashing against the boat, and Jesus is asleep. He is so physically tired. He gets it. And then when they finally awaken him, he will pronounce peace. He will breathe peace into the situation. And traditionally, we've thought about him stilling the wind and the waves, but perhaps in a whole nother way that's vivid, he has stilled the unease within the disciples who are faltering because of their own lack of trust in what God would do. Jesus understands. And because he loves you and me, he wants to be responsive. At least a century and a half ago, there was an explorer whose name I cannot remember, who was driven by conquest. And he was going to make a trek across all of Africa in record pace, eager for the notoriety that his discoveries would bring, headlines in the paper, you name it. To support this effort, he had hired a large group of porters who, of course, had to shoulder the load. Day after day, they seemed to march endlessly. And on this given day, he was up early and gave the order that the march would commence, and the porters just sat there with their burdens. He spoke to the head porter in very directive terms. It was time to begin. And the head porter said this. He said, sir, we are just waiting for our souls to catch up with our bodies. Plenty of us sometimes feel that way. You have a right to rest. In fact, your life may depend on it, especially if you choose to rest in the outstretched arms of a Lord who calls you dear. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, thank you, Lord. Amen.
May we now affirm our faith through the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Let us pray. Lord, again we give you thanks for this place and time in which we can so freely gather, bringing our lives together to worship you. We rejoice that we can offer and participate in worship through the hearing of your word, through prayer and song. And we continue to pray that we would never take these things for granted. We continue to pray for your wisdom and grace to fill and direct those who are leading congregation. We pray specifically for the nominating committee as they are about their work, searching for the ones whom you have called to serve as elders, deacons, and in many other ways. We ask that you would continue to stir in the hearts of those whom you have called to fill these places of leadership and worship. And we pray for the Gibson family, such a significant loss of a daughter, Sable. We pray that you would comfort them. We ask that they would have a profound sense of your presence, even during this extremely difficult time. May they know that you are with them. Comfort them in their grief. As we consider simplifying our lives and finding our rest in you, and we so often this is easier said than done. And so we continue to pray for your wisdom, your insight. I pray that our hearts would be open to your leading, showing us what truly is important and significant, so that we would pursue it. Not in a way that leaves us breathless because of fatigue at the end of the day or week, but in a manner that fills us with joy for the rich blessings and the opportunities that you've provided for us. And so hear our silent prayers for your help and guidance in directing our lives this coming day and week. And as with each Sunday, we continue to pray for those who are homebound, who are perhaps recovering from illness or surgery, who could not be with us. Please remind them of their importance to you. And hear our silent prayers for those whom we know who need your healing and encouraging touch. And again, we give you thanks that you hear all prayer, spoken and unspoken. And hear us now as your gathered people, we pray the prayer which your Son and our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we continue our time of worship together, may we present to God our tithes and our offerings.
in a somewhat amazing way, all 10 of our new members were publicly recognized at the last service. Sometimes it's been a bit of a challenge to get people to the early service. They all came to the early service, which was an absolute wonderful thing. I want to give you just a data point that might be helpful as you think about Sycamore and the future. This church experienced real growth last year. That means real numeric growth. We've had 10 new members join us already this season. There's every reason for all of us not only to be very hopeful and encouraged about the future of Sycamore, but to also know that the good things that have begun will continue to gain momentum as we step forward into God's great work among us. This is a very special place. You need to know that others recognize that and are drawn here. And that's why our own personal word of invitation and welcome is the best that we could ever hope for, to invite someone to share God's life here. We're grateful for the 10 new members who accepted that invitation, and we look forward to welcoming them more deeply into our life and work. Bless you, friends. That was nice. I need to remind us all that every time we sing that hymn, it was the favorite hymn of our late associate Shirley Hutchins, who died in 2014. She rests in the security of Christ's perfect care for all eternity now, and yet her spirit of hospitality is a part of our life and work even as we gather each Sunday. And so, in her own way, she would encourage you to go eat pancakes. If you have the opportunity to do that, go with joy. Live in faith. Believe that life is good. And if you find it not, help make it so. To the glory of God who made us, and may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship, friendship, and power of the Holy Spirit lead us forward together each step of the way.